Welcome to the BEC webinar on talent identification. This is within high performance, and it's a very interesting topic that we're going to talk about today. In the webinar, we're going to address different kind of areas of talent identification. The first area is going to be about what is talent. We're going to talk a little bit about how we define talent. And the next topic will be about how to spot talent. And the last topic would be about why it's important for us to talk about talents, basically. How do we use it? What kind of pros and cons are connected to talents? But before we get a little bit into the area, I would like to introduce a case. That's a normal situation that we are in when we enter a hall. Then we often go to check out the results of a match. And if we have a player which we can call player AA and who's playing against a player BB, then we have the result. The result could be that player B wins 21-10. And if we just look at the results, basically based on this, we would say, yeah, player B is the best player. And the question is then, is player B also the most talented player? And that's what, for me, talent identification is basically all about. We need to dig a little bit deeper into understanding why players are performing. So if we again look at the same match, we have the same result. We have player A, who is 11 years old. We have player B, who is also 11 years old. So from an age perspective, they are, what to say, equally. Then we dig a little bit deeper into it and look at the heights. If we have player A, then player A would be, for example, 120 centimeters high. Player A will also have a weight of 30 kilos. If we take the same approach to player BB, then we will have a player who is maybe 150 centimeters tall and weighs 50 kilograms. That means that player B has a physical advantage when we look at the performance and the results. So if a person is higher, can reach further on the court, is stronger, is faster, then of course there is a physical advantage that maybe can explain the results. But the question is player B then more talented compared to player AA? So from my side, it's always there's more to it than just the results, and we have to look a little bit closer into this area to understand what is talent and how to spot and identify talents. But first of all, we need to go a little bit in another direction. We need to look at what is the goal with talent identification. For me, it is to identify the next world-class badminton player basically as early as possible. This is not an easy task, but this is what's important for me as a talent developer or as a coach. The reason why this is important is that if I know that this player has the potential to become world class when it grows up, this young player, then I can invest all my resources into this player. The difficult part for us always is that we always have limited resources, so we need to use them in the best possible way. So if I as a talent developer can identify the talent early on, then I would use my resources in the best possible way. So this is the kind of, what to say, thinking as a talent developer when we want to spot talent. But let's move on and have a little bit a closer look at what is talent, basically. Some of the words that I normally connect to talent is basically that the player is natural gifted. They have natural ability. So when they perform on court, when they move on court, it looks like they have done it forever. It looks natural. It just feels like they haven't done anything else since they were born, basically. When I also talk about talent, then I also talk about potential. So I have some sort of expectation of something will come, or that this player has an extraordinary gift which needs to be turned into great performance, and then they can end up being world-class players in the end. Basically, we also often look at that we feel like they are better than the players at the same age as themselves. So this means that normally we feel like they perform better on court. Maybe they do exercises in training in a better way. They understand the game in a better way. But we have some sort of feeling of that they are a little bit above average of what you can expect at a certain age. Yeah, and as I said in the beginning, everything looks easy for them. It just looks natural, basically. So when we're talking about talents, then we need to look into these kind of words. But this is also, it's not an exact science where you can just measure everything. This is also about experience. It's also about understanding of how you develop talents. So if you have to spot the right talents, you also need to know about how you can develop talents during the years, basically. Well, when we talk about the word talent, basically we describe some expectation for future performance. So when a person is labeled or is named a talent, then we have some sort of expectation that this one can do something in maybe 10, 15 years, which is on a very, very high level. So we actually basically try to predict the future, but this is very, very difficult. And that's also why we have to be quite careful about using the word talent, in my opinion, because it's also connected to a lot of expectations. But predicting the future is very difficult. But if we have more understanding of how children develops and also what can be learned and what cannot be learned, then we can become a little bit better in predicting the future. So let's have a look on it. Let's have a look on how to spot talents and what to look for, basically. If we go back to the first case, or to a case where we have a match again, we have a different match compared to the first one. We have player EE playing against player FF. In this match, they are the same age, they have the same height, they have the same weight. So basically, there's no physical differences between the players. And if we look at the result, then it's 21-19, 19-21, 21-19. So basically, the match is even. So you can say both of them are talents, or they are equally good. So it's difficult to separate one from the other, to say the one is more talented than the others based on the information that we have right now. So the key point for me when we talk about talent identification is that we need to have a better understanding of their background. We need to have a background checking of why are they performing like they are. So if we dig a little bit into the training background, then we can see that the player EE has maybe played badminton for only 2 years. He is playing badminton 4 hours per week. If we compare that to player FF, has played badminton for 6 years and is practicing 8 hours per week. Basically, you can say that player FF has trained way more compared to player EE. And if we take the training background into consideration as well, then I would probably say that player EE is the most talented of the two players here, because this player has already performed quite well, but without a lot of practice. So I can add a lot of practice into this player, I cannot add the same amount of practice into player FF. So the background checking is extremely important of understanding why talents are performing. This will lead me to another area, which is also oft discussed in talent development and talent identification. And it comes down to different ways of training and approaching talents. And you can put it into something called early specialization and something called all-round training. Let me try to put a little bit extra words into what is characterized with early specialization. Early specialization means that you, from an early age, focus on just one sport. So in badminton, that would mean that we, from an early age, only play badminton. We use a lot of hours on badminton, and it's badminton, badminton, badminton. It also means that we, from an early age, have a focus on winning. So it doesn't matter how it looks like and so on, as long as we are winning. It's about winning, winning, winning. This can be mentally challenging, but it's a focus that is connected to early specialization. Then it also means that we have a high training load from an early age. So this means that we focus on one sport, We focus on winning. We focus on training a lot. And one thing that's also characterized with early specialization is that we are not trying to develop new skills, basically, but we focus a lot on optimizing the skills that we already have. So if I know like a few shots, then I try to make them as perfect as possible and try to make them as efficient as possible. But that's where it ends. So because this is what I need to be winning the next match. I'm not thinking about what's going to happen in 10 years. I'm thinking about winning the next match in the weekend, for example. So I try to optimize my shots, my movements, everything. This approach is quite challenging mentally because there's a lot of pressure connected to it. And it also often leads to that if you cannot handle the pressure, then you will mentally burn out at some point. So it can be very difficult to handle this approach to work with talents in this way. But you can say the outcome of this approach is that you will have good results in the beginning, in the early ages. So if you want to win the next match, this is the way to approach it. I'm not convinced that this is the right way to do it if you want to develop world-class athletes. That was what the goal was with talent spotting and being a talent developer, as I see it. We need to look into the future. We need to try to work with players so we can make them as good as possible in 10 to 15 years. If we look at the all-round training approach, it means that we actually encourage athletes to take part in more sports, not just badminton. They can play football, they can play handball, they can go to swimming, gymnastics. Basically, in the early ages, we want them to challenge their bodies in many different ways. We want to encourage them to take part in more sports. And that can continue up till they are 13, 15 years of age, basically. So we don't want to focus on one sport too early. We want to make this more all-round approach. It also means that the players will not maybe perform on the same level as the early specialization approach. But this is what we accept in the all-round training. In the all-round training, there's also a high focus on the process of learning new skills and developing skills. So that means in a badminton context that we have a focus on developing, for example, a lot of different kind of shots, different kind of movements, a lot of how to read the game, working on motor skills development as well. So it's all about improving, being in the process of learning and becoming more skillful as a player. We don't focus on what you can say, on winning. Of course, we would like to win, but we want to win in the right way, basically. Mentally, this is also easier to handle this because there is not like the next match is the most important match. This is more like focusing on different areas of how did you use what you learned in training in the next match. Of course, when we play badminton, badminton is a game where there will be a winner and a loser. But it's not the main focus with this approach here. There we focus on how can we implement the skills and are we winning by implementing the skills? Then of course we are very happy. But if we are not implementing the skills, then we can be a little bit like that. Yeah, we were winning, but we were not really improving our badminton game. Training load can be high also for the all-round approach. But it's more balanced because it's put out on more sports. So instead of playing badminton 5 days a week, as in the early specialization, then you might play badminton only two or three times per week. You go to swimming one time per week and you go to gymnastic one time per week. And there your body will be challenged in a different way. You will get a lot of motor skills learning and you will also, from an injury perspective, have a more balanced body, which will not be, affected as hard as compared to the early specialization. Because when you only do one sport, and especially with badminton, if you're a right-handed player, or your right side of the body would be stronger compared to the left side, and that can cause some injuries in the long run. So having this more balanced approach will actually mean that you can better sustain high training loads later on. But with the all-round approach, we will also have to accept that we will not be performing on as high level as we would compared to the early specialization in the early ages. So we will have more average results. But that's, if we know, if we have this in mind, then we, of course, when we have to spot talents, this can give us a better idea of why a result is as it is and who might have the potential to be, become the next world-class player. If we look at this graph here, then it's basically shown that you can see that the early specialization approach will mean that you will race quite fast with your results, but at some point you will level out. With the all-round training approach, it will be, yeah, as I said before, not the same kind of results, but at some point you will actually exceed the early specializations. And that means that you will, in the end, reach an even higher performance level. And if we want to develop world-class talents, then we need to understand that what they do in the early years can actually benefit them later on when they become 20, 25 and they turn into world-class athletes. Because the goal as a talent developer, as I said in the beginning, is to make world-class players and also to spot people, players in an early age who has the potential of reaching this world-class level. So with this in mind, we need to be careful that we don't pick or spot talent just based on results, because with the early specialization approach, we would actually, or we could end up choosing players who has just practiced more than others. And this is not what we want, because with this knowledge, we will also know that they will not reach the same peak performance level when they become world-class athletes. What's also important to have some knowledge about when spotting talent is about how children develops. So that's especially around puberty. This is a period in kids where there's a lot of change both body-wise and also in the mind. So the, if we look at, for example, as we did in the beginning on the first match with the player AA and the player BB, there we had two players who had physically different sizes. There can actually be up to 4 years difference in physical size of kids before puberty. We also know when they enter puberty, they will start to grow. Their arms will get longer, their legs will get longer, but also their minds will change. They will develop basically in a lot of different ways. If you look at girls compared to boys, then girls will enter puberty on average 1 year earlier than boys. So it also means that often girls will seem more mature in the way that they deal with different kind of situations, especially before puberty. And it does mean that girls are more talented or skillful than boys. It just gives us a way to explain why boys might sometimes be a little bit silly in the way that they handle the different kind of situations. But we need this kind of knowledge also if we want to spot players, that just because a girl is very mature early on doesn't mean necessarily that they are more talented. It can just be an explanation of the natural development of kids. So the key point here is that, as I see it, it's impossible to predict how puberty will influence the physical growth and the mental development of the players. But we need to have this into consideration when we look at players, but also think about that spotting talents early on might be very, very difficult. The older they get, the easier it is to say, okay, this one has it or doesn't have it. But the younger they are, the more difficult it basically becomes. So that could influence also our approach of how we want to work with talents. But if I have to spot a talent, then I have to be careful in the beginning, in the early years. If we try to look at the next model here, there I have tried to make quite simple, making four stereotypes of how to look at talents. If we look at the first example, there we have a player who has a high potential, which you can see with the blue, or which is marked in blue here. So if we look into the future, this could be a potential world-class player. It also have a quite high level already, So if I look at this player here, then I would say, okay, this is one who is jumping into my eyes when I'm going into the hall and see, okay, this is a player who's performing quite well. They might also have good results. Everything looks fine. And I have done my background checking. Okay, so it seems like this player can be maybe a future star. So for me, I would characterize this type of players as like the natural gifted ones. This is an easy yes for me as a talent spotter. Say, okay, this one has the potential to become good if they can turn the potential into abilities and skills. Then you can also have a player who is, he or she has only the half potential, but the player has the same level right now. This is where it starts to be difficult, because you have to understand how you define potential, how you see potential, how that can be turned into performance, basically. But if you have the two players playing against each other, then they will play an even match. But of course, the easy yes will be the one who will, in the future, in 10, 15 years, be the one who will be world-class, where the other ones will basically not improve much from where it is. So from a talent spotting perspective, this is what I would characterize as a difficult no. This is the one who is difficult to say no to. They're saying, I will not invest in you. I will not put you in our talent program, because you might not have the right technique. You might win on because you're physically bigger than the others and so on. And that's difficult for a kid to understand, of course, and equally as difficult for parents to understand. But as a talent spotter, talent developer, this is what we have to do. This is our task. If we move on to the next one, then we also have a player here which doesn't have much potential, basically. The level is also low, so basically this would often be the ones that we never see when we go to a tournament. We don't recognize that they actually are performing well or actually playing, because the skills are not good, and basically they don't have the potential. So this would be an easy no. Then the interesting part is the last stereotype here. There we have a player with a huge potential, but the level is low. The current level is low, so when you're 10 years old, you might not be a skillful badminton player compared to the easy yes or the difficult no. But this player is very, very interesting. If we can spot these players, then we are doing a great job as a talent spotter. So there, our knowledge of potential, of what to look for, it's very important, and the background checking is even more important. So there might be a reason that this player might not be as good compared to the others right now. Might be 10 years old, might play a lot of different kind of sports, so they haven't like optimized the badminton skills. But these can also be difficult to find, because this is probably not always the players who goes far in the tournaments. But if we start to know the player, if we work with the player, then we start to get a better understanding of how this player develops. This also means that if you look at talent spotting, we need to look not just at one tournament or at one point of time. We need to look over time. How does the players develop? Do they continue adding on extra dimensions to the game? But getting back to the stereotype, this would be for me the difficult yes. It would be difficult to first of all spot this player, but it would also sometimes there would be some pressure from the outside saying, why do we pick this player? Because this player basically is not as good as the rest of the players. But this is where our knowledge comes into play. And if we can predict or pick one of these players now and then, yeah, then we are doing great spotting as I see it. We have to dig a little bit deeper into what to look for when we are spotting talent. And we're going to divide a little bit into the technical area, the tactical area, the physical area, and the mental area. Technically, as I see it, we need to look at how the players is performing the strokes. Are they using the right techniques? Are the right movements in place and so on? Do they have the right grip? Or using the right grip, do they have a relaxed grip? We also have to look at the number of strokes that the players are able to do. If they're only able to play clear drop and net drop, yeah, then we know this is not gonna be enough if you want to be world class. But if you can add way more shots to your game, you might not be great in it when you are young, but if you have a lot of of different kind of shots that you try out, that you can see that you can develop, and you have this perspective, yeah, then I think this is quite interesting. That's also why when you look at talent spotting, you have to look over time. You have to see if the players are adding more strokes to the game. The same count for footwork. Are they using the right footwork? Are the movements in place? And so on. And basically also, for me, it's quite important to have a look on the center of gravity. Can they stay low in the movement? We know if you want to be good in defense, you need to get down to the floor. You cannot just be standing upright. That can be difficult during puberty because you're growing quite fast and your muscles are not strong enough basically to handle this bigger impact. So this we also need to understand that during puberty, during the growth spurt, there you will actually have players who have a little bit more difficulties in moving around. But again, if they're able to do or work with low gravity or center of gravity, then it's interesting for me from a footwork point of perspective. Tactically, anticipation is important for me. Reading the game is important. So if a player is able to anticipate what is happening in the game and position him or herself on the right spots on the court, then it shows for me tactical, I'll not say knowledge, but understanding of the game. And this can also happen in an early age. So for example, if your opponent is under pressure on the rear court, then it feels natural for you to move forward to the net because most of the shots will come short and then you have a good position of winning the point basically. So if you start to monitor these kind of understanding of the games without discussing too much tactically, yeah, then it's for me a good sign of tactically talent, if you can say so. Then it's also, if we move a little bit to the later ages when they become, more mentally developed and also can understand more complexity, that will be during puberty or late puberty, then the ability to analyze a game. And if you have a game plan, you can follow this game plan. So this is for me like the next steps if I have to look into the tactical area, if they have talents basically. Then for me, it's also the ability to identify specific tactical situations. So the one I described before with the pressure on the rear court, if you can handle more of these kind of situations, then you also have tactical talent in my opinion. So the tactical area is something in the early ages where it's more like a feeling of the game, and then in the puberty and later ages becomes more something that you need to understand basically. If you go to mentally, and this is an area for me that's basically the key area of becoming a world-class player, because a lot of the areas you can learn, but you need to have the right personality, and this has also to be developed. But that's also a part we need to look for when we start to spot talents. And the most important part for me is that they have a growth mindset. And what is meant by growth mindset? This means that they basically have an ability to want to develop. They want to become better. They take on the responsibility on themselves. Also, when it doesn't work or they fail or whatever, then they still say, okay, it's me. I have to change things. I need to work. It also means that they are able to handle criticism. So if a coach comes and wants to correct something, then they take it on. So they are always in a process of becoming better and looks for opportunities to develop, basically. Then they also need to have an inner drive. It cannot be someone else who wants them to become good. It cannot be the coach. It cannot be the parents. It cannot be a friend or whatever. It has to come from themselves. So the players where it's very difficult to keep them out of court, that's the kind of players we want to look for. The players who's always in the hall, who's always looking for these 5 minutes to play a little bit extra, who just wants to play with everyone, basically, because they are in love with badminton. They have this inner drive of wants to play badminton all the time and wants to become better. If it's driven by somebody else, then with my experience and all the players I have worked with during the years, then I know it will stop at some point. So the inner drive is a key factor of becoming good. Then we know that during a badminton career, it will go up and down. So So when it starts to become tough, that's connected to the growth mindset. Do they still have the willingness to work hard? Will it still come to training? Will they still try to overcome the difficulties? This is the kind of mindset that we need, because it's not going to be easy to become world class. It's not like just everything becomes easy just because you train a lot, then you will become good. That's not how it is. It's going to be tough. There are going to be difficult times. There are going to be times where you might be injured, or you don't feel like you're developing, or you're losing games that you didn't expect to lose. You need to work through this. You need to continue and believe that you can become good. Then one thing that's for me quite important as well is that you need to be willing to invest the hours in the sport. You need to be willing to train a lot. Nobody becomes good about training a little bit. The best players trains an enormous amount of hours, and they just want to continue. So if you start to have difficulty saying, okay, I need to go to practice instead of going to a party, yeah, then for me it's a little bit of sign, do you have the right inner drive? Do you actually have the right mindset of becoming a high performer? This I can only know if I start to talk to the players, if I start to understand the players. And that's also why I need to dig deeper than just the result. I need to have a better view of who is this person that I predict could be a talent. Yeah, and then, as we talk a little bit about here, failure is a part of becoming better. But it's about how you handle failure. If you feel like every time you make a mistake, then everything is just really awful and you just want to quit everything, then you might not be in the right, doing the right thing. But if you see like failure, yeah, it can hurt and you can also be disappointed, but you want to turn this failure into motivation, inner drive, energy to become even better. Then I think we are having some of the right persons to work with here. Finally, independence is important for me, because if I look at how the players on the highest level, how the daily life is for them also when they're in tournaments, then there's not a person who is just telling them everything they have to do. They need to be independent. They need to take responsibility of when to go to sleep, when to do the practice, what to eat, and all these kind of things. It's not just about badminton. And for me, if you're not independent, and you can see that from an early age, if the parents is basically taking control of the kids by carrying the bags, and every time there is an issue, then the parents go to the coaches, then for me, it's a bad sign. It doesn't mean that it cannot change, but this is for sure something that needs to change, in my opinion, if you want to become world-class. You need to have your independency and the inner drive to push yourself forward. If you go to the physical area, I've already been a little bit around it here. But for me, the basic motor skills is quite important. That's the reason why I think this all-round training approach is quite important if you want to become really good. Because there you're working on, you could say, basic motor skills, because you're working with skills from different kind of sports. So the body will be challenged in a lot of different ways, and that will basically improve your potential of learning new skills later on. So for me, basic motor skills are very important also when we have to identify talents. So that could be basic motor skills like just running forwards, running backwards, jumping, and these kind of things. It can be from sports like how do you throw a ball, how do you catch a ball, can you dribble with a ball, and so on. These kind of things is also important to have an understanding of. So because it can be a limitation in the end, if you are not able to run backwards, for example, or not good in running backwards, or changing between running styles. So the ones who has like the physical talent, not just in strength and power, but also in ability to move the body, this is gonna be a factor in the end of who's gonna reach the really like world class, and not just becoming just a good player, but a really world class player. Then I think it's quite interesting to look at the small players who is physically weak, if they perform well. So if I'm entering a hall and I can see a small player is actually beating a lot of other players, basically I'm looking at the results, but I dig a little bit deeper into saying, okay, I have a small player here. Why is this player able to beat the physical stronger ones, that starts to be interesting for me. Because then this player will have other abilities. That could be that they technically are extremely gifted, that could be that they tactically are smart. So I have to look at these players and to find out, is there something interesting in these players? Natural speed and power or explosiveness is important for me because that's like something you're born with. Of course, you can practice it in a certain way, but there are people who just have muscle fibers that is more explosive compared to other people's. And the people with the natural speed and this kind of muscle fiber composition has an advantage in badminton because you need to jump high, you need to hit it hard and so on. So this is quite interesting for me to have to look at who is naturally fast. Of course, the ones who is not naturally fast, that is a disadvantage, but it doesn't mean that they cannot become world-class players because they can have excellent skills in tactical anticipation of the game or technically, so they can compensate for the speed. But if you want to have the world-class players, then you need to have a really high level on all areas, basically. So if we have to like sum it a little bit up, then I think that most of the skills can be learned if you are in the right talent development environment. If you have skillful coaches, but also who has this long-term perspective of want to develop you into the best possible player. Not just winning the next tournament or the next match, but really want to develop you into reaching your full potential as a player. If you are in that kind of environment, then I think you have a really good chance of becoming good. But it's about the skill perspective. It's about focusing on developing and the learning process. That has to be the key factor, especially in the early ages. Then I also would say that it's important to look for development. It's not just this picture that if we have one match, one result, that's not gonna cut it. You need to look at development. So if you want to spot, you need to check out the talent more frequently. And even better, if you are a coach working with a different group of players, then you will have a lot of information of how the players are handling different kind of situation and also, of course, can monitor the development. So development is a part of spotting talents. It's too easy just to say, okay, I have a result, I have a winner, this one is the next future star. That's not how it works. Then for me, especially in the early ages, especially before puberty, it's important that we don't rule players out of becoming future stars because it's extremely difficult to predict and because we cannot predict how puberty is actually influencing the development of the players. But it's also to say that there can be a huge difference of the amount of training that they have already done. So in the early ages, I think it's way more important to include more players into the talent group instead of excluding people. Because then we would end up that we will exclude very often the difficult no. So they will basically be told, you cannot become a world-class player because you are not as good as the others and we don't believe in you. And then they will probably stop playing badminton because they have a natural gifted. They will also become good in other sports. So if football or swimming thinks that they can be talent there, they will probably end up in this sport if they have a desire of becoming world class. So for me, it's important to include instead of exclude players. Does it then mean we have just to take everyone? No, it doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that everyone can become a world class player. But I think if we include more players, then we will have, in the end, more players having the chance of becoming world-class because we will have the difficult no's which we can put into to the talent pool, basically. And this is our job, as I see it, as a talent spotter and developer. So if I have to sum it all up and talk about some takeaways here, then I think the result do not tell the full story, if a player is talented or not. We need to dig deeper. Background checking is important. And that means training history, that means physical understanding of the players, look for the development of the players over time, so we have a better understanding of why a player is performing and maybe not performing. Then I would also look at the difficult part of spotting talent comes down to pick the difficult yes. This is really, really difficult, but it's so important that we do this because then we will have more gifted players. So that means, again, as I said just before, include instead of excluding players, especially in the early ages. And then pay attention to the early specialization. And that's often the difficult no. If we can exclude these players because they are not developing or having the right skills and so on, yeah, then we're also doing great talent spotting. But again, we still need to be careful, especially in the early ages. Now we're going to move to the last topic of today. That's we're going to talk about talent and why it's important to talk about talents. Basically, we need to ask ourselves, how does it help a player to be named a talent? We all know this, that we see the media and then we say, wow, this player is a huge talent. She's going to be the next Carolina Marin. Or we have this, that's a player who's won a big tournament. He's probably going to be the next Victor Axelsen. Parents, spectators, media people likes to announce the next big player. Especially if we can do it in an early age. But the question is this actually the right thing to do? I'm not so sure. And I'll try to explain a little bit why. If we look at the pros and cons of being named as a talent, then some of the pros would be that you get more attention, basically. From media, you can potentially get more sponsors, the coaches, maybe the club will help you more, maybe the association will help you more. So being named a talent has some pros in getting the attention. It can also be a confidence and motivation builder because somebody is basically telling you you're good. You can become really good in this. But I'm not sure that this is long-lasting confidence and motivation. I think it's just everybody likes to be acknowledged for what they are doing, but also what they can achieve later on. But I think it can be a little bit, there's two sides of this kind of attention. Yeah, and when people have to select, if they don't have the knowledge of talent spotting, of course, we will have some of the difficult no's who will be selected as well here. So if you are named a talent, then you have an advantage in the selection process. If we look at some of the cons of being named a talent, then for me, it could turn out to be if somebody feels like they are talent, they are natural gifted, that they will lack this inner drive of becoming better because they're basically just being told, you have it. You can do it. You will be good at some point. You don't even have to practice for it because you are talent. It is natural for you. If this is the way that they handle being named as a talent, then it's a big issue for me. Then it doesn't help them to be named a talent. Then there can also be a lot of pressure connected to be named a talent because, as we said in the beginning, there is expectations connected to be named a talent. We're trying to predict the future, and talking about talent, we talk about potential, we're talking about how good can you be in the future. So if you're not performing well being named a talent, then you can start to have doubts. Are you actually gonna make it? So there will be some pressure connected to it. So for me, I think one of the questions is, how does it influence the next training that you have to approach if you are being named a talent? As I see it, if you're named a talent or not, you still need to have to work extremely hard. Nobody becomes good without training. Nobody becomes good without a lot of training. So you still have to work hard. And it's not like you have an advantage when you play a match. So you can say, okay, I've been named a talent. So I can start with 5 points and my opponent starts with zero. That's not how it works. You still have to start from zero all. You still have to put in the training hours. You still have to handle a difficult time. So basically nothing changes if you are named a talent or not. Still the same. You still have to do the training. You still have to become better. You still have to develop. So why name a talent, basically? In my opinion, we should not use too much time on it. I know the understanding of it's easy for coaches and media to talk about talent. If we have to say, okay, because we know it's connected to potential. But basically, telling players that they are talented or not, for me, doesn't make sense. I think we could basically kills somebody's career by naming them talents. I would rather focus on the process, focus on the daily training, the work that has to be done, the skills that has to be developed, because that doesn't change if you are talent or not. You still have to do it. Yeah, that's basically it about talent identification. I hope you found it interesting and also gave you some different perspectives on talent identification. You're always welcome to reach out to me if you have some questions regarding talent identification, but also other areas within development and high performance within Badminton Europe. Thank you very much for listening and have a nice day.